So there's this show, it's called Hunter the Parenting. You write it and you might have seen it. It's based in White Wolf's World of Darkness franchise.
Now, paradoxes.
And follows mostly mundane people hunting vampires, werewolves, and other creatures of the night, the mean streets of Norfolk, UK. A lot of people in the comments section report really liking it. So, thanks, guys. But lots of comments also mention they'd want to learn more about the setting. Not just hunter or vampire or whatever beastie of the week we present, the wider world of darkness. We got those comments a lot back in the old TTS days, but with Warhammer. And this time we thought we'd act on them. So that's this. So if you want to get into World of Darkness,
let me be your guide.
Content disclaimer. This is our first time ever doing a video essay, and so this is very experimental. Also, I am not the master godbrain who has been playing World of Darkness since, like, I was a protoplasm. This is the wadbrain of someone who got into it, a while ago, back in high school, and just my personal experiences. There's going to be people that have been more invested, know more, and probably have a better idea of whatever the hell they're talking about than me. But I've got quite a reasonable perspective on things, and I like to think I know what I'm talking about. Cut this. This was a completely unscripted ramble.
No, fuck you, Stason.
I'm Speaker D. This is Ogre Popenang, whatever that means, and this is our very first video essay. So let's get started. Let's start with two things. Number one, World of Darkness is a tabletop role-playing game first, and everything else second. There's video games, card games, books, etc., but it all sprang out of the tabletop setting. Number two, as this is a role-playing game, in order to immerse you best into the setting, we're gonna start with you. Yes, you. Bear with me for a second. Have you ever gone on a solitary walk at night? You walk under the pale glow of streetlights. Shadows smother your familiar surroundings. No one ahead of you. No one behind. No one but the faint sound of passing cars and an infrequent, dull hum. It doesn't really matter where. A suburban cul-de-sac, some dark corner of a city, or maybe a dirt road in the country. It doesn't really matter. Have you ever gazed up at those buildings, the ones cloaked by night, and wondered, what secrets are they hiding? Who uses this place? Who's in there? That weird farmhouse you always pass, the crooked sign. The apartment above the boutique store, whose lights flicker rhythmically in the night. Or maybe the suburban home, the one choked with weeds. We've never seen anyone enter or exit, but you've always spied that same rusted car in the driveway. In our normal, everyday world, these things aren't that deep. Inside the farmhouse is a normal family. The apartment needs to call an electrician. The house is just vacant, or has bad owners. Simple as. The World of Darkness is a lot like our everyday world, but more specifically, it's the secret world. The one hidden just behind the mundane. The lights flickering in the apartment window aren't random. They're a signal, and when decoded, they tell their beholder the exact time and date of their death. Within that vacant suburban home, a coterie of vampires gorge themselves on slumbering neighbors. As the nights pass, more homes grow vacant. Missing posters paint the streetlights. And that farmhouse, the family? Normal as normal can be. But if you look with the right eyes, you'd see the spirits of the countless buried in the dirt, howling the names of their killers into bleak, uncaring night. World of Darkness packs dark urban fantasy just past the everyday periphery. But there's one more twist. Unlike our lives, where most people are shut out from grim and hidden workings, here, you're in on it. In World of Darkness, you aren't the man on the street. You are the vampire. You are the ghost. You send the signal. You bury the bodies. Sounds morbid. Gothic. It is. But you can throw all that in the garbage, because World of Darkness is also Clown World! Hello, welcome! Dracula is real. He cut his way to vampirism and everyone hates him because he's famous!
That Dracula guy's a fucking scary.
It's an evil fast food chain that puts literal demons into their cheeseburgers. It is owned by the same corporate death cult that owns the evil beer company, doing the same thing to their beverages. The reason they do this? To subtly convince random people to beat their wives.
This is not a joke!
You want more? Oh, I can give you more. In 1914, a deranged inventor named Sir Varga was so disgusted at the capacity for mankind to destroy, he brought a giant Zeppelin armada across all of Earth's cities and declared himself world emperor. A hit squad composed of secret agents, killer robots, and biofreaks were barely able to force him to retreat, and then real-life scientist Michael Faraday vaporized him so hard they both exploded, and everyone on Earth just forgot this ever happened, because the New World Order covered it up! I feel insane! And I'm not even talking about the steampunk explorers fighting Nazis on the Hollow Earth, or the ancient kingdoms of the Lizard King setting is off its shit! It's got some pretty crazy stuff in it. But unlike my maximalist lore drop, it's also a cool. Let's take a step back. Save for those moments where the comedy of absurdity of a situation just completely takes the reins, you probably won't notice how incredibly elevated the world is, because Wad plays it pretty grounded. Only the DM, or storyteller, really sees how deep the rabbit hole goes. For most everyone else, it kind of feels like the world we know. Just a little darker and a little more absurd. For example, Wad vampires are thought to bear the curse of Cain, the first murderer featured in classical hits like the Bible. This literally doesn't matter at all to the 20-something stoner who got turned by his Tinder date. Hell, he could live in Scheme for hundreds of years! And it still might not matter. In fact, it probably won't. See, Wad has a lot of advantages in setting itself in our world and our time. In World of Darkness, you aren't just relying on what a DM thinks of an evil world should look like. You're relying on a DM's knowledge of the real world to set your scene. Most DMs have no idea what a medieval economy looks like. They haven't really thought through how the world would change if a 90-foot giant shit lightning in the local textile industry. Nor should they be expected to. That'd be a lot to expect. Honestly, you'd have to be a messed up medievalist to get anything done. But you... you live in the world you're playing in. You know what happens if you call in a bomb threat to an airport? You know about how long it takes to drive from Houston to New Orleans? You know how much gas costs, what can be found at a local grocery store, and the shit you don't know and need to research? Brother, it's the real world! What do you think's gonna happen if a 90-foot giant shits lightning on your local meadery? But beyond just being our world, Wad has its own feel too. Yes, a lot of familiar locations exist, but World of Darkness is going for something a bit more elevated than an adventure localized entirely within your local Greggs. In my completely subjective opinion, Wad is best described as No Country for Old Men, as directed by Suda51. No, that doesn't necessarily mean Anton Chigurh running around with a beam katana, necessarily. Instead, it's the dry humanity of No Country for Old Men, skirting the edges of the law and the world of the known. It's the familiar town where fiction painfully meets fact. Heroes taking their chances have their luck run out, while evil is implacable, inescapable, mundane, and no less immune to the normative conventions of the world they live in. The coin travels across time and space, from minting to now, to save a cashier's life, and another makes the same trip to take someone else's. Or maybe both were as meaningless as the money people die for. Into this formula comes the saccharine madness reminiscent of Suda51's No More Heroes or Killer 7. Hammer horror monsters run webs of shadows, where blood is lubricant to an uncontrollable mosaic of agendas. Just as characters can be drab like No Country, they can be bright and shining, vibrant with camp, mystery, stupidity, or intrigue. There's a sense that you're caught in this bardo state, a place between life and death, between the pawn, the king, and, if you're fortunate, the errant spanner in the works. It's a celebration of mayhem, decay, or at least the people who live amongst it. Maybe absurd, but those absurdities just mimic the off-kilter beats of our own manic world. That's just my take on it, though. My world of darkness. But to hear Wad describe itself, the term it lands on is gothic punk. I like it, it's got a nice ring to it. But what exactly does that mean? Well, to hear it from them.
The term gothic punk best describes the decadent ambience and rebellious fervor of the world of darkness. Violence blends with elegance as wealth and privilege mix into the panoply of fear and cultural conflict. In cracked, squalid cities, people dance and while away the hours in glittering social clubs, trying to ignore the urban center's decay. The towering buildings of the downtown scene cling to art-graven styles. By contrast, slums roil with strife and warfare as desperate masses of humanity claw at their pieces of turf. Under the gleaming spires of the church, the halls of justice, and the artifacts of society, the masses strive for lives of comfort and refinement. The gothic image of looming architecture is everywhere, chased with gold and silver as it watches over the dispossessed. In contrast, punk nihilism echoes in the overpowering despair of dreams destroyed. Ignored by society, the less fortunate rebel. The upper classes revel decadently in their wealth, while gangs, criminals, the insane, and the deprived maraud through crumbling neighborhoods. The buzz of technology is nearly overwhelming, as disenfranchised groups revolt through shocking displays of brutality, art, faith, and mysticism. The world careens down a fast track to self-destruction, and everyone wants an escape.
That's the creator's vision, and honestly, it rings true. Most game lines have that kind of dichotomy, the one between the monolithic power structure versus the burgeoning voices of those that haven't quite bought in. What could a setting where Draculas control Amazon's board of directors be if not gothic? What is a setting where you can smash their faces in with a golf club if not punk? Before I get sidetracked on a never-ending ramble hole, though, besides the unique feel and elevated supernatural shenanigans, being set in our world has advantages other than knowing how much a hot dog costs. It also gives players at the table an onus to make characters that feel real. Sure, those real people might be vampires, or have some elevated profession like hitman, rockstar, criminal, CEO, but it also empowers you to make your PC a 28-year-old garbage man named Chuck, who just happened to get wrapped up in whatever game line he's in. In my opinion, it's one of the most fun ways to play. Just make your character sheet what you'd expect a garbage man to have, give him a few hobbies, figure out what matters to him, and then just jump off from there and see where you amble. It's not some Dark Souls wretched playthrough handicap either, by the way. In my home vampire game, between the member of the esoteric snake cult and the overworked car mechanic, it's the car mechanic that's left every encounter with a body count, and the cultist, who tends to have to staple their tongue back in their mouth once some mean beastie caves their teeth in. All of this is probably overwhelming, and that's kind of on purpose. But Wad has this really bad reputation sometimes. It's a game only for ephemeral thespians who take their role-playing and setting very, very seriously. And yeah, those guys definitely have a place. Quite frankly, close-knit communities of goth LARPers built this fucking city. You might think that's cringe, but you might also think that the world is flat, so get over yourself. But much like in our world, in my most humble of opinions, Wad is a lot weirder than that. It's not some solitary penumbral orb of misery and mope. It's fucking hilarious and strange and warm and heartfelt, just as it's tragic and dark. Wad is a place where, much like the real world, you can go from horrifying tragedy, harrowing encounters, dreadful monsters, And then have a two-hour in-character argument stuck in line for fast food, trying to explain to Dale, the food service worker, why you're covered in foam war blood. It's a crazy world, and there are so many different flavors of WoD to choose from. Run as a monster, clinging to their humanity as a vampire. Be a frantic survivor, desperate to wake others up to a supernatural menace and hunter. Or turn into an 8-foot werewolf and fight a radioactive death shark in werewolf. Yes, this is the thing that happens to werewolf. Yes! It's cool. It's also dumb. Is all this pretentious? Yes. And maybe a little too subjective. I mean, I did just tell you that WoD isn't so self-serious before hitting you with a few film school essays. But Cringe is dead and I'm still breathing, so that's the way it's gonna go. If anything I'm rambling about sounds even halfway interesting to you, keep watching, and you'll probably like what you see.
Part 2. Game Philosophy.
Before I keep selling you the legend of John Henry's hammer, though, I should tell you how WoD earns the accolades I've been heaping on it. Most TTRPGs are built on the famous three pillars. That's combat, exploration, and social gameplay. Some games flex especially hard on certain pillars. Pathfinder First Edition wouldn't be Pathfinder First Edition if you weren't busting the mechanics open like some multi-armed gunslinger tycoon of the action economy. Meanwhile, a game like Call of Cthulhu is all about the mystery and horror of Lovecraftian fiction. Players aren't called adventurers, they're called investigators. And that's because the game focuses more on the pillar of exploration than rushing down Yogg-Sothoth with a blicky in a pocket full of dreams. Likewise, as you probably guessed, World of Darkness is the role-player's roleplay game, with emphasis on your character first and everything else second. Therefore, it leans most heavily on the social pillar. What does that mean? Essentially, if you're tuning in for Vampire Diablo, then there are better games for you. The systems here are built around drama, suspense, and politicking. Combat's fun, but it's also incredibly lethal and risky. Any schmuck with a shotgun can get lucky and remodel your face into a vertical conversation pit. Unless, of course, you're a werewolf, an 8-foot-tall killing machine of Gaia's vengeance and fury, except for also, no, it's still possible! Just more difficult. You're not invincible. No one is. In WoD, the game isn't usually about plundering a dungeon. It's about maintaining whatever stressful life you're presently leading, struggling and changing as you're bounced between unseen agendas, all while fighting to make your own possible. WoD is ultimately a game about the players, their decisions, their goals, more so than other RPGs. You set your agendas. You decide what's important to you. Your storyteller is there to guide you, to challenge you, and ultimately build a satisfying arc. Different game lines have different ways to approach the more social, character-driven aspects of the game. These approaches are universally interesting, and something I'd love to go more in-depth with for individual game lines in later videos. Here's a few in a nutshell, though. In Vampire, you play as a monster, forced to drink the blood of the living to survive, struggling and compromising with your darkest self to retain your humanity. It's an experience best summarized in the signature phrase, "A beast I am, at least a beast I become." In Mage, you are an enlightened will worker with a unique gift, the near limitless power of magic. And with that magic, you can quite literally change the world. The question is, how will you? Do you have the right? And have you thought through what happened to the world if you did? Or hell, what happened if you didn't? Wraith in particular has a very strong concept. You're dead and gone. A verifiable ghost with a whole world of ghost politics and ghost intrigue surrounding you. But all of it is artifice. At its heart, Wraith is about moving on. Your goal isn't to become king of Ghost Mountain, it's to confront your death, accept it, and leave your character behind as bravely as you can. This act of confronting mortality, of essentially starting play with a character who ideally won't survive, it's very interesting. I think it's pretty powerful and bold. And the only reason more people don't play it is because another player at your table contractually has to whack you with a horsewhip all game. It's very weird, kind of adversarial, but it can be good! Only play it with your rabbi, your priest, your polycule, whoever you trust, but hey, you want to hear more about combat? Let's go! Depending on the kind of creature you're playing as, you have different systems working to keep you more alive than the average Joe when some psychopath is belt-sanding your skull in half. But no matter what you are, you need to plan your engagements, at least a little bit.
Fight dirty. Try to strike first. Strike fast. Strike when the guys you're trying to decapitate aren't staring directly at you, because even if you'll probably win a fair fight, you could also suddenly and unexpectedly not. This more realistic approach to combat not only encourages you to fight sparingly and find other means of resolving conflicts, but it also gives you, the player, a leg up on even the biggest of bads. This is because the metric for oh fuck for essentially everyone in the setting is 3-6 people with shotguns hanging out somewhere they don't expect them. That statement on the dangers of combat shouldn't be confused to mean every beastie is a pushover, though. Vampires take bullets like love taps, a werewolf pack decisively wins the M1 Abrams matchup, and mages can essentially deal with anything so long as they've got prep time. But whether you're running a hunter's cell, a vampire coterie, or a wraith circle? Circle? They're called circles? Anyway, no matter what your boy band is called, the thing that can give you the edge over supernaturals more powerful than you is this. The base rule for everyone else in World of Darkness is something to the effect of, fuck you, got mine. Most greater societies, organizations, or deeply troubled people tend to go it alone. When they confederate, it's usually on deeply unequal footing, with strangled ambitions and treachery around every corner. Predatory people act like predators for all the good and all the ill that nets them. So that's a strength for your special group, who, ideally, do not all hate each other and or are not actively plotting each other's death. Ape together strong, so if tactical plastic placement fails you, know that just having a circle of dependable friends and allies is a hidden X factor in a world like this. For those paying attention, yes, you're goddamn right, the power of friendship is meta in World of Darkness, just like it is in real life. This shouldn't be taken to think that all supernatural creatures are weenies, though. Vampires juggle dumpsters, the Fae can shoot death beams by playing the ukulele. It's just that even with that kind of firepower, damage in combat is kept somewhat realistic. Mark Henry is a very strong lad, but if I ran him over with an 18-wheeler, his strength would not avail him. Probably. Maybe the best way to view it is mostly realistic. It's not as if there are painstaking systems meant to reflect getting your wounds infected or whatever. In fact, as dangerous as combat is, you can sometimes pull away with even the faintest of odds. Case in point. I have one memorable story of a game where one of my players very bravely leapt out and started doing kung fu shit at a group of heavily armed PMC door kickers. He beat the snot out of one, but was seemingly oblivious to the fact he had put himself point-blank range with his rear to a man with an automatic shotgun. This should have been the end of his character, for despite their kung fu moves, they had no protections outside of their leather jacket. Yet, somehow, that bastard managed to walk away! Not just with their life, but with nary a scratch! Is that because it's a dice game and I rolled the worst damage in the world? Yes. But it also illustrates a point. Because on the other end of the spectrum, you have moments where getting shot point-blank with a shotgun does not result in a small boo-boo, and instead bypasses powers granting invincibility and immortality. This is best seen in 5th edition's Conclave of Prague, a lore event where a surprise shotgun blast turned the perfectly chiseled face of Camarilla faction leader Hardestaff the Younger into a goopy splattering of extra spicy element soup. Despite the fact that the guy had a near-complete mastery of Ventru's super durability. Personally, I've had it both ways. The combat isn't realistic in the sense that things are modeled realistically, and you have to make sure your wounds don't get infected and all that armor fantasy shit. It's realistic in the sense that combat is confusing, tumultuous, and dangerous. Outside of Werewolf, WoD is not typically that combat-focused of a game, so when it does happen, combat accentuates the social consequences of battle, namely, the risk of death. So why then, if it's so dangerous, would anyone get involved in combat? Because, dummy, it's fun! Also, your characters probably have something to fight for. And if they don't, dumbass, you probably have a boss you're beholden to that's gonna make you do shit you don't wanna do because they don't wanna do it. Whether it's your ideals, your own survival, or pure self-interest, most inhabitants of the World of Darkness will eventually find violence filtering into their lives. WoD has a strong emphasis on corrupt systems of power. Almost every game line has a heaping helping of row row fight the power baked directly into it. Unless, of course, you choose to row row be the power, in which case your prerogative is making sure anyone fights the law has about as much success as the Bobby Fuller 4. Fight the yoke of the ancients as an anarch vampire, or jockey for your place at the top within the Camarilla. Toil to bring magic back to the world with the Council of Nine Traditions, or keep the masses moving towards your utopia and the technocratic union. Or fuck it! Sit it all out! Don't pick a side! Trouble, inevitably, will always come to you. but the choice and its consequences are always yours. So, if you're ready to play a tabletop role-playing game that focuses on exploring your own special snowflake as they struggle and suffer in a hostile world of freaks, if you're okay getting your head popped off because Soup Can Joe, the heavy hauling hobo, rolled six tens on their firearms roll, if you like vampires, werewolf, wizards, and urban decay, World of Darkness might be for you. The only question is, where do you start? The answer is a video game. World of Darkness is lucky enough to have several excellent video games under its belt, but the one everyone talks about is Legendary Crime Against Semicolons, Vampire, The Masquerade, Bloodlines. Do not let punctuation fool you. Bloodlines is very, very good. A classic, some might say. Many people might say. Many people might say better than me might say. So I won't go into exhausting detail. If you've never heard of this game, there are many excellent breakdowns on Bloodlines to pursue at your leisure, but take my word for it. If ever there was a WoD primer, by God, it's this game. In it, you play a freshly embraced vampire of your chosen clan, plunged headfirst into a web of undead politics, treachery, and other hot topics. Your decisions matter, the characters feel human, and nothing has encapsulated the feeling of World of Darkness better, in my opinion. Is it flawed? You bet your ass it is. Don't ever ask me what a Quajin is! But to be brief, I highly recommend it to just about anyone who has ever drawn breath on the planet. Just, play the unofficial patch, because everything bad you've heard about Hollywood sewers is true. But I know you want more! You want the TTRPG! So I'm gonna tell you where to start there, too. But first, ad time.
Imagine, if you will, you are on an airplane. It crashes into the Atlantic Ocean, and miraculously, you survive. A scream, another survivor dragged into the brine. Fins emerge, the hungering, deadly maw of a great white shark swimming straight for you. In this situation, wouldn't you rather be at Noble Knight Games?
Noble Knight Games has given us a mysteriously sourced bag of money to promote this anti-shark propaganda.
And also, to remind you that it is the premier location for tabletop games and RPGs in Madison, Wisconsin, where you now live!
Are you and your coven suffering from symptoms of dystopium and looking for a new, fresh RPG franchise to fill the void?
Oh, you are?
What?
None better to help plug that gaping wound in your Sunday evenings than Noble Knight Games!
You wanna play Vampire the Masquerade?
Which one?
How about Vampire the Requiem? Oh, that one. That's gotta be...
Oh, there it is! How do they do it? What's going on?
And they have Mummy in stock. Okay, I'm less scared. It's safe to come out again.
Wargaming?
They got it.
Boards games?
They got it.
The Spear of Longinus?
They keep it in the back.
Glue? All the glue you can eat.
But what to do when that Mafia book you need is sold out?
Well, add it to your want list.
You'll get an email as soon as someone with the book dies and their possessions are contributed to the Noble Knight Game Archives. Thank you.
Or if someone...
sells it to them.
Through their buy and sell program, which you can also do! All this with a free shipping within the US for any order over $149, as well as a flat rate US shipping option with all orders shipped out within 24 hours, which indeed covers your order of 15 blood-dimmed tide supplements, you mermaid milk freak! Do you see this knight? He fights for your freedom. He does want to kill you, but he won't. Why? Because gamers like you populate his web store, buy his goods, and temper his wrath. In conclusion, who was D.B. Cooper? I don't know, but you might find the answer at NobleKnight.com.
Part 3 editions.
Okay, have you played Bloodlines? Yes? Great. Did you not? That's fine too. I mean, it's a great game worth your time, but not all necessary, just useful. It's a great way to step into the world, especially if you have problems getting a stable group together for a tabletop game. But supposing you're ready for that step anyway. You've got a table wanting to try out World of Darkness. You, know how to play a tabletop role-playing game or are otherwise excited to learn. Where, amidst all these crazy WoD books, do you start? That's a complicated question. Let me lead you to the answer. First, you'll need to pick which game line. Each game provides different creatures you to take the roles of, different themes and toolboxes to play around with. For instance, Love everything I've talked about with combat. Werewolf is, and always will be, the most combat-focused WoD game. Start your search there. Want intrigue? Every game line does intrigue, but few do it as well as Vampire. Or fuck off, disregard all of that. You think elves are cool? Play Changeling. Cast a mighty spell and play mage.
If you fucking dare.
Play whatever. All the shit I talk about in the themes is optional. You can make any kind of game you want with these systems. I'm just covering what the default is slanted towards. Here are the issues you're going to run into, though. For one, WoD has been around since the 1990s, and it can be easy to get overwhelmed by choice. Which book should I play? Which edition is the right one? Etc. That's number one. Here's number two. Despite the wide bevy of WoD games, they're not all updated to the latest edition, 5th. In fact, at time of writing, only two are. Usually there's not too much of an issue playing between editions, but with 5th, there is one. Or, more of one. Slight changes in how difficulty, damage, stats, and other things are handled make it harder to cross over with older games. This means you have several essential choices. Option 1. At time of writing, only Vampire the Masquerade and Hunter the Reckoning have 5th edition variants. Thus far, compared to earlier games, 5th edition games focus on smaller stakes and slower XP growth with weaker characters. This is done in service of creating a more intimate feel for the players. And it works! It focuses on making you feel less like a character in the World of Darkness and more like a person. In my humble opinion, it's quite successful at that. Early trends involve bigger factions being weaker and more flawed, and more of the onus is on the younger generations to fight for their place in the world. I have overall less to say about 5th edition, largely because it's pretty self-explanatory. Pick it up, play it, and enjoy. Just know that everything else has yet to fully arrive. It's a strong edition, and I'm sure the best is yet to come. It's also worth noting, if you watch the very excellent LA by Night and New York by Night live plays, this is the version of the game they're playing. There are new resources being pumped out for 5th with increasing regularity, and it's not going to remain the edition without all the other goodies forever. I'm just giving it slightly less focus, just because there's fewer caveats here than other places. But it's genuinely worth your time. If you want to run a Vampire or a Hunter game, this is definitely the place to look. Option 2. 20th Anniversary Editions. Before 5th edition, the edition of the land was WoD 20th Anniversary. These were released, get this, in celebration of WoD's 20th anniversary. They were essentially released for veteran players of the day, and as a result, they can be kind of rocky to learn at times. The idea being, you should already have a firm grasp of the concepts within. The lore has a slight tendency of being either too reverential to old material or just plain sparse, but it's the edition I started with, and I turned out alright, so I still highly recommend them. Most games enjoyed a pretty cool 20th anniversary release, and in my opinion, it's still the edition to run if you want crossover shenanigans. Compared to 5th edition, you'll likely be able to roll out with a comparatively more powerful character, but there's also a lot more jank. Balance isn't really at the heart of WoD, given it's just, you know, not that kind of game, but it's a lot easier to break than 5th edition for damn sure, for better and for worse. It's not enough that I'd not recommend them to a newbie, but it is enough to warn about, so consider yourself warned. I just warned you. Despite these caveats, though, outside of the occasional weirdly worded subsystem, it's not like 20th anniversary is a major downgrade. In fact, I know plenty of people who still prefer playing this edition to the newer ones, and I can't really blame them. Even for games with 5th editions, if you wanted to run a vampire game where you're all elders and not snot-nosed neonates, fuck it, 20th ain't a bad choice. These editions are hideous, lumbering monsters. You'll notice I'm insulting them a lot. That's because I love them all. I don't own just one 700-page Mage 20th Core rulebook. I own two, and one has a weird stain, and I don't know where it came from. 20th is also so accommodating that you can easily just take older supplements and quickly adapt or even straight up use their adventures, powers, merits, and flaws in your own game. Even if the content you're looking for is ancient, you can probably dig through any old WoD book and find something that can fit in your game with a few tweaks. My friend Odoroshi once ran the prehistoric crossover module Midnight Circus for our home group of 20th anniversary characters to great success, even though it was originally printed 2 months after my birth. Sure, a lot of the content aged poorly. A lot of the content aged poorly. But the underlying concepts and many of the characters and situations were fun and easy to translate to 20th parlance. The parts that didn't? Well, our storyteller just filled in the gaps with her own original content, got rid of the stuff she didn't like. It's not just modules either. Area splats, faction guides, hell, even some main game lines have languished in earlier editions. But it's all still accessible thanks to how adaptable the older storyteller system is. I mean, think about it. Before the D&D 5th edition reprint, could you imagine running classic Tomb of Horrors in the modern system? Well, you could with WoD. I mean, not Tomb of Horrors, but, you know, Evil Circus Hell and the this crab thing. Anyway, the TLDR is this. If you want to play Werewolf, Mage, Changeling, or Wraith, or if you have a style of play that clashes with 5th's design philosophy, 20th is the spice you're looking for. Have fun! Option 3, Stygian Madness. Sadly, not all games got a 20th anniversary release. Some games have languished in their sordid states for eons with barely an errata in sight. They are few, but they are infamous. And some people really, really like them. Essentially, if you're looking to get a rousing game of Demon the Fallen or Mummy the Resurrection, you're going to be looking at old rules. Fortunately, these are going to be relatively self-contained and explicable within the language of their own text. WoD game lines be like that. I cannot advise much in this juncture, for I have rarely afforded myself such terror. I've used Demon the Fallen rules for NPCs in certain games, and it was universally a harrowing experience. It was like being submerged in the dim waters of the River Styx, and losing all that I am. That being said, the games have their cult followings for a reason. Be brave, play them, and have fun! But know that if it's your first time, it's probably a bad idea to start here. It won't be too challenging once you have a game under your belt, though. Option 4, Chronicles of Darkness. Oh boy, this one is... it's gonna take a hot second. Here's some history. Sometime during the run of WoD, the developers decided that enough had been done on the metaplots to warrant a global update. Modules were released for end-time scenarios for all game lines. You got to pick your favorite ending, and the idea was is that they'd say goodbye to the setting forever. In its place came the new World of Darkness, now known as the Chronicles of Darkness. This is a completely different, confusing continuity that is extremely different from the old World of Darkness. In Chronicles of Darkness, you do not play Vampire the Masquerade. You play Vampire the Requiem. You do not play Changeling the Dreaming. You play Changeling the Lost. Confused yet? So am I. This isn't quite WoD. For Warhammer fans, think of WoD as fantasy and Chronicles as Age of Sigmar. For one, the rules and systems have been streamlined and optimized in a way that even 5th edition took notes from. For two, the world and game lines are similar but very distinct, with some real standouts. In particular, Hunter the Vigil is a very cool take on the Hunter experience. Whereas the older version of The Reckoning focused on supernaturally augmented imbued, Vigil focused on normal hunters, introduced numerous cool and creative hunter compacts, as well as the concept of becoming a slasher, a fucked up kind of hunter that went from being a slayer of the supernatural to a metaphysically augmented serial killer. Each tribe no longer focuses on the imbued, and I think that's because Hunter the Vigil just kicked so much ass. Changeling the Lost also gets its fair share of accolades. Changeling the Dreaming is well known to be somewhat inscrutable, difficult to understand, and a massive glowing orb of madness floating silently in the classic WoD catalog. Changeling the Lost simplifies the story a bit. Instead of playing as the Fae, you play as someone cursed by the Fae, which grants a very distinct play experience. It also makes the games radically different from each other, to the point where I'd almost warrant to say the Lost is just its own weird little thing. Chronicles is still getting updates, such as an actually living mummy game and several unique permutations like Deviant, Promethean, and Geist. If it tickles your fancy, it's not a bad idea to check out, but you should know that if you're looking for World of Darkness books, Chronicles is something different, so be aware. Now, all of these different ways to play may sound intimidating, but don't worry, there's even more! WoD Dark Ages, WoD Wild West, WoD of the Victorian Age, WoD's incredibly vibrant and legendary LARP scene, there's a lot! Fortunately, it's not all half as intimidating when you realize the base mechanics of World of Darkness are all incredibly simple. Better still, for all their subvariants and additions and blah 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 blah, outside of the unique gimmicks for each supernatural subtype, the core mechanics deviate very little between the games. That's because every mainline book you aren't playing can serve an additional purpose as a bestiary. Your non-furry friends deny you the opportunity to run the werewolf game of your dreams? That's fine. Throw a mid-level Get a Fenris into their condominium and watch the fireworks. The sole exception, of course, is 5th, but even then it can be done. It's different, but not that radically different.
Part 5! Mechanics!
So how simple is it? Simpler than D&D, to be honest. The core mechanic of WoD is this. All editions utilize a simple D10-based dice pool system. D10s look like this, and character sheets look like this. At character creation, you decide which skills and attributes your character has by filling in the dots with the game's allotted budget. Dots represent how good you are at something. One dot is below average. Two is average. Three means you can make a career out of it. Four means you can make a great career out of it. And five means that you're one of the best of the world. Someone with strength 5, for instance, is one of the strongest people on the planet. Someone with medicine 5 might be an internationally acclaimed neurosurgeon, whereas a med student might have medicine 1 and a nurse medicine 2. So, putting that into practice. This character has 3 dots of firearms and 3 dots of dexterity. They're a good shot and they're fast to boot. Unfortunately, a blood-sucking freak of nature is running right at them! They need to put those skills to good use. They need to roll to shoot that bastard into the Stone Age. When making a roll, you take a relevant attribute with the skill you're using, in this case dex and firearms, and count their combined dots. Then you just roll that many dice, and boom! You'll have a target number, usually 6s, and everything above that on the dice are successes. Tally your successes, and that's the result of your roll! In this roll, we got 3 dice hitting our target number, so we've got 3 successes. A direct hit! With rare exceptions, this is essentially how every action in the game is performed. Wanna stab a guy? Dexterity plus melee. Wanna not shit yourself on a first date? Charisma plus expression. Easy peasy. The advantages of this system are its ease of use and flexibility. Example. Firearms' typical function is to point guns in people's directions and pull the trigger. But if you wanted to field strip a gun, it's also what you'd use. You could also use it in an investigative sense. Perception plus firearms to determine what kind of gun scooped some poor victim's brains out. Hell, if the storyteller is feeling especially kind, you could probably use it in a social encounter too. Impress your fellow gun freaks by speaking enthusiastically of your waifu with charisma firearms. Alternatively, if you're about as intimidating as a baby capybara, as a last-second desperation ploy, perhaps you can scare off an encroaching foe with a sick display of gunmanship. Manipulation plus firearms. Roll high, or else you might catch a hollow point in the skull for your troubles. Are these combos the only combos you can use for such things? Absolutely not. Sometimes actions can actually be accomplished through multiple combinations of skills and attributes. For instance, a storyteller might allow you to field strip a firearm with the firearms, technology, or craft skills. But not all rolls are equal. The storyteller may require more successes for rolls they think are a stretch. I typically wouldn't disallow a Dr. PC to synthesize a drug using medicine, but I might make it easier if they used science, chemistry, or botany instead. Personally, I love letting my players get creative with skill use. It's the same reason why I encourage most PCs to have a few useless skills. Sure, your 2 dots in law might seem useless at first, but when the party face fails to convince that cop that you definitely 100% know nothing about the string of disappearances you've been causing, your Dark Horse law skill could be the difference between getting him to come back with a warrant and a prison arc. That's sort of the soul of what makes Wad Wad, you know? It's got an incredibly easy to get into dice system that doesn't overly concern itself with mechanics bloat. It's not completely rules light, like Powered by the Apocalypse, but it's less hindered by exacting systems and, like, I don't know. Item carry weight. What can you carry? I don't know. What the storyteller thinks you can carry. If it beggars belief, make a check. Okay, you'll know how carrying all that weight affects you. A good, adaptable storyteller and a gaggle of creative miscreants can have a hell of a time telling their story using this system. And really, what more can you ask for?
Part 6. The End!
And yeah, that's pretty much it. I mean, there's more. A lot more. Too much to willingly shove into one video. I could clobber you with tales of the spirited LARP scene, talk about all the incredibly poorly aged WAD supplements, like the Mafia book. Oh my god, Alpha loves the Mafia book. Next slide, get it away. Being honest, each WAD game line would take its own video to get into the gritty of them, the unique mechanics, themes, and other nuances. So, fuck it. If you want more videos breaking down individual WAD game lines, let us know in the comments. But for now, to avoid a deadly bloated mass, we'll wind down here. So, let's review. Step 0. Play Bloodlines. Step 1. Get a good group. Step 2. Pick your game and edition. Step 3. Pick a day, time, and place, and step 4, start running. Do all these things, and the world of darkness should open up to you. I love WAD. It's the most fun I've ever had rolling dice. I hope with this video and Hunter the Parenting, we've helped some folks get into this incredible game and community. And if we haven't...
Failure. Perhaps next time.
You have watched an Ogre Popenang video essay. Written and presented by Speaker D. Animated by Karl the Deranged, Garrett, Alfabusa, and Dr. White. Script editing by Speaker D, Erndil, Alfabusa, and Dr. White. Audio composition by Karl the Deranged and Alfabusa. Audio mixing by Stringstorm. Music by Mackeerre, Glowtide, Stringstorm, Karl the Deranged, and Vrinde. In-house art made by Nostalgia, Inktooth, Iron Irokal, Garrett, Eliphas, and Rude Rubicante. High-end male modeling performed by Speaker D. Mutilation of high-end male modeling performed by Erndil. Additional music sampled from Vampire the Masquerade Bloodlines original soundtrack by Rik Schaffer.
And Frederick Knutson, you forgot to credit Frederick Knutson when you were recording for the credits. How can you forget our boy?
Featuring original World of Darkness art by Alex Scheichman, Leif Jones, Michael Gados, Guy Davis, Ron Spencer, Steve Prescott, David Leary, John Cobb, Jeff Lobenstein, Steve Ellis, Langdon Foss, John Van Fleet, Vince Locke, Tim Bradstreet, and many, many more. Please consider seeking out and supporting the extraordinary artists who create the lens by which we see our wonderful world of darkness. Special thanks to Blessed for incurring the wrath of the Varkalak. Great job!
Wait, what?
An especially big thank you to all of the devious nightfolk on Patreon generously funding this endeavor. This includes Angus, Anthrax, Mango Grunt, Matthew McLeod, Meth, Banana Butt, Benel, Black and White TV, Boy Blurry Face, Brave Beard, Brian Ross, a lot of bees. Well, that's okay, because we also have Opossum Sam, Paladin North, Peter Steller, Portero, Koros, Corporate Shepherd, Corporate Shepherd, Dan, who can forget Dan, or the Taco Bomb, or DH, Diane Travis, Salsa Vermilion, L. King, Sindarin, Some Guy, Sover 1998, Gans, Gem de Philippis, Goblin, Griswell, The Hot Soup, The Servo Skull, The Master Meep, Tia Singer, Torbjorn Andreas Solberg, Jake O'Lantern, Jason, Jean-Luc Picard, Jesse Walker, Zerobit, Yogue, Josh Tellum, and Zuberel. And a special thanks to our Avatar tier members, who, for a modest fee, will get portraits such as these before you. Look at that guy. That guy's like a flamingo. You want to fight about it? Oh! Portions of the materials are the copyrights and trademarks of Paradox Interactive AB and are used with permission. All rights reserved. For more information, please visit worldofdarkness.com.
Don't steal that broomstick, you fuck! Oh, you are going to have to go to jail for this, you fucker! Or you can pay with gold! What is it? Gold, eh? Well then, it's off to jail with ya!